The Sarasota County Bar Association is a proud partner in bringing you Law in Sarasota. With voluntary membership of over 900 lawyers and judges, the Sarasota County Bar Association is your community's leader in advancing legal professionalism, practice development, and public service. Visit www.sarasotabar.com for more information and to use the online directory list to find an attorney.
This program is brought to you by a grant from the Community Foundation of Sarasota County and the Sarasota County Bar Association. The Education Channel produces the program and broadcasts from its state-of-the-art campus on Beneva Road. They make this program possible. Hello, I'm Senior Circuit Judge Lee Haworth. Our program today will be of interest to students and parents. We're going to talk about a remarkable program that keeps delinquent kids out of juvenile court, and at the same time, provides insight into the judicial system. So it has an educational component as well as a diversionary purpose. I'm talking about the Sarasota Teen Court. We have as our guest, Heather Todd, Teen Court's Executive Director. Welcome, Heather.
Thank you so much for having me, Judge.
Let's talk a little bit about the history of Teen Court. It's got quite a distinguished history. Tell us how it got started and how it's got to where it is today.
Absolutely. It's a feather in the cap of this community. In 1986, the League of Women Voters reached out to the Junior League when they saw a rise in the delinquent crime rate. The Junior League, as they do, pilot projects. Faye Rice, Judge Logan, Debbie Gigliotti searched across the country for innovative ways to handle young people that had committed a crime, good kids, poor choices. They found a program in Odessa, Texas, Youth Court. They brought it back to our community, and in 1988, we opened our doors operating as a non-for-profit program.
And you've had a distinguished executive director. It was your predecessor. Who
Correct.
Was that?
Correct. Katie Self came on board 6 months into the program. She and Debbie Gigliotti went across the state, opening, at the time, 64 other teen courts, also called youth courts.
So you were the first.
We were the first in the state of Florida. Absolutely.
And actually, I have to give a shout out to Katie Self because she received a very distinguished honor. She was the Florida Bar Foundation recipient of a non-lawyer award, the Medal of Honor, for her services as the executive director. And that's quite a distinction very few people get. So you've got quite a history behind you. This is a diversionary program. What does that mean?
It means that we give young people an opportunity free of a conviction on their record. So doors of opportunity, whether it be colleges, whether it be the military, whether it be professions, certain professions, all of those doors of opportunity are open to the young people that complete our program successfully.
Well, a lot of the kids think that there's no consequences for getting in trouble, breaking the law, and getting a delinquent history. What's your take on that?
Yes, well, at teen court, there are meaningful consequences. A jury of their peers are going to listen to the facts of the case. That client or defendant or offender is going to get on the stand, and they're going to tell that jury what happened with the situation. There's going to be a prosecuting attorney, they're teenagers that represent the state. There's going to be a defense attorney, a teenager that represents the defendant. And there's going to be a clerk and a bailiff in the courtroom, again, teenagers, that are going to, just like regular court, keep the facts of the court and keep order in the courtroom. That jury is going to deliberate and decide meaningful consequences for that young person. So real consequences.
Well, how about the kids? What's their incentive? I mean, kids believe that they can get in trouble and none of that's going to follow them into their future life. Is that accurate?
Absolutely not. An arrest or a conviction on their juvenile record can absolutely close doors. The best example, certainly a conviction on a juvenile record closes doors to the military. It closes certain doors to certain colleges and absolutely certain professions. Certain charges on a juvenile record, for example, a battery, an aggravated assault, felony offenses can close doors of opportunity.
And it can affect their ability to get grants for college tuition, as well as you said, the professional licenses. So what type of charges, let's say, What are the typical charges that a child would face that would make them eligible for teen court?
Absolutely. Certainly right now the most popular is the possession of marijuana and a petty theft. But we also handle possession of alcohol, battery, any type of fight, trespassing, vandalism, driving without a license. We do handle traffic offenses, driving without a license, driving on a suspended license. We have a fleeing to elude right now. So any type or type of misdemeanor and nonviolent felonies we also handle. We're special in this community because we operate as a non-for-profit. Again, one of three across the state that do so. We're able to handle cases that maybe other communities don't because of our relationship with the state attorney's office and the 12th Judicial Circuit.
So what happens, let's say a student at school takes a cell phone
Correct.
From a backpack belonging to another. They're given the option, instead of going to juvenile court, they could accept teen court as a sanction.
That is correct.
And do you require them to admit the offense?
Great question. So they have to accept responsibility because teen court is a sentencing hearing. So that defense attorney is going to defend their actions
the
and
kid
explain.
Defense attorney.
That's right. Yes. That teenager defense attorney is going to explain the actions. And really, they're going to let the client do so while they're on the stand. There is going to be an adult judge that oversees the process. But that young person has to explain why they did it. They may have a reason. They may have an excuse as to why. But they have to accept responsibility and explain why they made that poor choice.
So if they're successful with teen court, that charge, the say in that case, a theft of the cell phone disappears.
So fantastic example. If it's a civil citation, it goes on the prevention side of the Department of Juvenile Justice database. If it's a school referral, it comes directly to teen court and it's on their file in the schools, but it's dismissed when they complete successfully. If it's on the traffic side, then the fees are waived and again, it's dismissed. So best case scenario, whether it's a civil citation, a school referral, a traffic offense, if it comes from juvenile court, adjudication is withheld, which means they are not convicted of that offense as long as they complete teen court successfully.
Okay, and one of the values to it also is that the family gets involved. I take it you work with the parents too, and they get to see what their child's up to. I think from my experience with teen court too, the juries are very sensitive to outrageous stories by the kids. In other words, the kids may tell a story to their parent that makes sense, but the kids will call them on it.
I love that example because absolutely, the kids get it. I always say the kids get it. So I may sit in that interview or our case manager may sit in that interview and I always say, you know, be snowed. They'll get snowed because this young person is just, you know, telling the story. And then they'll get in front of a jury of their peers and their jury of peers, they get it. And we'll find that the consequences are so much more than even if they had gone through juvenile court. They'll get a high number of community service hours. Part of that offender's obligations or sanctions are to come back and serve on a jury for other kids, just like these kids served on their jury. They'll get a high number of jury duties or an essay or report. It's always very interesting because that jury, made up of both offenders and volunteers, they're listening, and when they deliberate, it's very obvious that they care.
Well, I take it because of the nature of these charges, there has to be close coordination between your office and the state attorney.
Correct. A fantastic relationship with the law enforcement officers in our community, with the state attorney's office, with the Department of Juvenile Justice, with the schools. I mean, we talk about wraparound services. What can we do as far as restorative strategies for this young person? Let this be the only time that they get into trouble. Let them learn from this opportunity.
And you've made connections with all the schools so that when they have one of these incidents, they know that teen court is an option. And how does that referral work? Say something happens and an police officer on campus sees something happening. How would they coordinate with teen court?
It's as simple as filling out a referral. One sheet of paper, faxing it to our office or emailing it to our office. We then contact the family and find out when it's good for to do an hour interview. We go to the school. We have case managers on campus one day a week. And then teen courts are always held in the evenings. So we really do what we can to accommodate these families because not everyone, it's simple for them to leave work. Some of them work two jobs. So we really accommodate the family in any way that we possibly can.
So teen court really acts as a way to keep the kids' fingerprints out of the official record of the juvenile division.
Absolutely. That is our ultimate goal. Free of a conviction, free of fingerprints. Let this be a lesson at 12, 13, 14, 15, all the way up to 18 if the crime was committed when they were 17. That way every opportunity is available to them when they graduate.
So say a student is charged with an offense, goes in front of the jury, they find basically that they think he needs some sanctions. What are the typical sanctions? You say community service.
Correct, and jury duties. Jury duties are their favorites. They like the young person to come back and serve on a jury because you learn so much. Maybe that young person is there for possession of alcohol. Well, on any given night, they're going to see a battery offense. They're going to see a petty theft. So you're learning while you're there. But the kids also may experience a substance abuse program that we do on a Saturday. We also have mental health counseling options. We also have a risky behaviors class where we talk about social media responsibility and anger management. So it's really the wraparound services. We have to look at every young person individually. We cannot, not everyone fits in this hole or in this box.
And the state attorney can veto teen court and say, no, you got too many serious problems. We're going to put you through the system and make them go that way. It's up to them to do that.
So, it's absolutely true. I very rarely see it. We have a fantastic state attorney's office in this community that care about these young people.
Well, they have to admit responsibility, but it's not held against them later on if things fall apart.
That is absolutely true. That is correct.
Okay. So being charged with a crime is not the only way to participate in teen court, is it?
I mean, no.
You get kids, I think in school you have to have a certain amount of community service otherwise. How does that work?
So this year we saw over 5,000 young people at the beginning of the school year recruiting volunteers. So we go to every high school in this community and a couple of middle schools that have asked us to come on campus and recruit their mature eighth graders, I always say, because if a young person is interested in volunteering, let's get them in there. The best piece, the most important piece of teen court is the civic engagement piece. Let's show these young people that their voice matters and how to make their community a better place. So yes, we have the volunteer side. And then our ultimate goal is that the young people that came through on an offense, that they continue volunteering. So we know we've won when they continue volunteering.
What are the community service options other than serving back with teen court?
So we do several things throughout the year. An example would be we just had our food drive. Right now, the young people can donate for the young people that are struggling at the holidays, whether it's gift cards or gifts or clothes. We're constantly thinking outside the box of how we can get young people involved. I also have opportunities in our office to volunteer. But also be mentors to the younger kids. We've had kids as young as 6 come through teen court.
Goodness.
But for the most part, we're looking at 9, 10, 11-year-olds.
Okay. Let me take an example of a parent who has a child who's starting to act in a way that's concerning. They haven't really broken the law or been arrested, but the parent would like to be able to get this child into a situation where they can be some mentoring and there can be some guidance, and you've got some programs that do that, right? Talk a little bit about Camp X-Ray.
Absolutely. So we just had a phone call today from a mom of a 12-year-old. She's starting to see signs of the young person getting off track, and I just applauded her for picking up the phone and giving us a call because we have what's called a parent referral, and it allows that young person to receive services before they get into trouble, right after they've gotten off track. Camp X-Ray is held on a Saturday. We start in the morning with the Sarasota Police Department in their community room, and we actually do an introduction where we introduce officers that are going to spend the day with the young people that are going to participate. And we do a physical piece in the morning.
Is it drug oriented?
It is. Thank you. It's a substance abuse program. Having said that, it's also for young people that are getting off track, and we want to show the reality of consequences if these decisions continue. It is a lot about substance abuse because we're going to go to the ER, we're going to go to the morgue, and we're going to go to the Salvation Army and visit with the Vipers program graduates.
Well, there's been a surge mm-hmm. in some behavior that's very troubling to school officials with whom I've spoken. Mm-hmm. And it involves vaping
Correct.
And this Juul business that
Absolutely.
They... First off, let's explain what that is.
Sure. So I think we all know it initially as the e-cigs, and then it's produced into these vaping.
Electronic
and then now
cigarettes.
We're in the, that is correct. And then now we're in this phase of Juuling. And my experience has been the kids are lacing their vials with very, very serious, whether it's a particular controlled substance or even something that they don't know what's in there, and we're going to go with rat poison. And depending on what's in that vape, I've had young people lose consciousness, end up in the ER, in intensive care, passed out. If they're on, I've seen it all. I've seen it all.
Well, the e-cigarettes are basically a nicotine delivery system that can be tampered with.
That is correct.
With flavors and all other things to make it attractive to mm-hmm. the youth. And their image is that it's harmless.
That's right.
But we know that it's not. And trying to get that message across is very challenging, for, not just for the parents, but for the schools and all the people involved with the youth community.
And we're getting trained as well. I mean, this is all very new to us. Across the state, I was just at a conference last week. They're experiencing it everywhere. But we're going to start pretty quickly having workshops and being more informed, because the kids are a step ahead and we can't let them be, because it's very, very serious. It's as serious as what we saw was going on with the bath salts
and the spice.
And all, that
yeah.
is correct.
I mean, we had kids that attempted suicide mm-hmm. and had to be mentally committed to a hospital because of the unpredictable effects of these materials. But anyway, the teen court is there to get an early start on that, to try to stop and divert them from that path.
That's
and,
right.
And parents can actually volunteer their children to go do this, right?
Correct. So if a parent is finding these vaping products or these e-cigs or the Juuling, give teen court a call. Let's see what we can form as far as education, as well as meaningful consequences for these young people before it becomes very serious and becomes a habit, and they're an addict. I mean, we've really got to put this in as a prevention piece.
Well, there may be some parents and maybe some students here that would be very interested in the program. Do you have a website?
Correct. SarasotaTeenCourt.org.
That's easy.
That's SarasotaTeenCourt.org. We go year-round. In North County, so in Sarasota, we do this every other Wednesday night, year-round. We just opened our doors in Northport, a satellite office or session in the chamber down there, one Monday a month. And we're at the Venice location one Monday a month. And mature eighth graders all the way up to 18, as long as they're in high school. We would love to have them, and they choose the role.
Well, this program is called Law and Sarasota. So tell me, what role do lawyers play and judges in this operation?
Absolutely. So the Sarasota County Bar Association has partnered with Teen Court for forever. I've been there for 19 years, but Katie was there 6 months after. We celebrate our 30th year this year. And for as long as I can remember, the Sarasota County Bar Association lawyers have been volunteering and presiding at Teen Court. So in Sarasota, for example, we'll do 3 courtrooms on a Wednesday night.
Wow.
Yes, and so every courtroom will have an adult judge. They are the mentors as well as the educators to our volunteer attorneys, our teen attorneys.
I know two of our retired judges were very active in it. Paul Logan, Manatee-based judge, and also Bob Bennett, who is
Correct.
From South County here in Sarasota.
Absolutely.
Spent a lot of time doing that.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about your orientation. How does that work? When you start the program every year, how do you go about recruiting people, getting them to be involved?
So we had an orientation in October for new volunteers, but they can start any time. That new volunteer orientation, I actually had Judge Logan there and sharing with the young people the history, because it's so important, but also, you know, what we're doing today. And it explains every role. We have the young people explain the roles in the courtroom, and the young people, the new volunteers, can choose their role. So if they want to do jury duty, they can. If they want to do clerk, bailiff, they get to decide that. But if a young person picks up the phone next week and decides they want to volunteer with Teen Court, they're going to observe twice, and then they're going to start doing the role of their choice.
Okay. So tell me about how you're funded.
correct. So I always say we constantly are begging for money. We're very fortunate this community, Sarasota County, gives us a grant every year. We apply for a grant, and they have, and we appreciate that so much. We get a $3 fee that is for traffic tickets that we are, fingers crossed, will be almost $100,000 this year. But the rest we really piece together like a puzzle, asking for grants and writing grants and asking for donations. And it's very unique to operate this way, but I think it's really important when we talk about the young people and their records and implementing services. We drug test every young person. Teen courts across the state can't do that because of HIPAA, and I think it's a disservice. Every young person that comes through our doors that is a client or an offender are going to be drug tested. It allows us to look at the big picture. We may have a parent that says, oh, absolutely not, my child isn't experimenting with drugs. I know it, I'm positive of it. And then here we sit with a positive drug test for cocaine. And now we need to have an honest conversation about what this looks like. I don't think we can serve these young people without a drug test initially.
Well, let me just tell you a statistic that was shocking to me. Periodically, excuse me, I ask for the statistics for the drug testing at our juvenile assessment center. People should realize when a student is, or a young person is arrested, they're sent to the JAC, the Juvenile Assessment Center, and every youth that comes in, we test for illegal substances. And this is these are not children who are necessarily brought in for drugs. It could be for a shoplifting, it could be for a trespass, could be for a battery, a whole range of things. We're finding 60 to 70% of those test positive for marijuana.
Oh, yes.
Which is really disturbing. And teachers will tell you that it's pretty pervasive and ubiquitous in the schools, and they know that. Now we have the vaping issues to consider. So there's obviously a need for diversionary programs like yours. And have you had, you've seen successes with that, with addressing it?
Correct. So we have between a 6 and 8% reoffense rate overall. Our substance abuse, so our Camp X-Raid program, is actually between a 4 and a 6% reoffense rate. So very impressive. And again, it's the young people that are doing this fine work. That's impressive compared to juvenile court, where they have a 42% reoffense rate. So again, at teen court, these kids get it, and they're holding their peers responsible, which is important. And so in this community, when we talk about, you know, what can we do to make this community a better place, I think it's rely on the young people that are making good choices and allow their voices to be heard. They, when we find that the defendant comes back and does a jury duty and they're surrounded by volunteers, that positive peer pressure starts to work. It's a very, very cool thing. And that's, we know, that carrot that gets that client back as a volunteer.
One of the things I think I'd like to bring out, because it's very significant, is that this is not an organization or a 501c3 charity that has a lot of administrative support. How many people basically run?
We have a North County case manager. We have a South County case manager. I have a COO. We have fancy names, and I'm an executive director, but there are four of us. There are four of us. We handled over 400 clients last year, so over 400 offenders. We have over 300 volunteers. So yeah, we're doing, and we saw over, last year over 4,000 students across Sarasota County, 4,000 with the law-related education piece. So we go into the schools and we explain that any amount over $300 is a felony. We explain the importance of what you and I have talked about in the past with the sexting. You know, when they're taking pictures of themselves and they're sending it to each other, I don't think they understand the seriousness of it, even though they're sending it to their boyfriend or girlfriend. So it's important to do this law-related education piece. But yes, we do it with a very small staff.
Well, talk about the other programs that you have. You have a peer circle?
We do.
Tell us about that.
I love peer circle. Peer circle happens right before court, and it's about 45 minutes. And we have different organizations come in and share their mission, but we educate the young people. An example would be, this week we just had Department of Health come in, and we did a social media responsibility piece. We have Integrity Building. We have Safe Place and Rape Crisis Center come in. We have the STAR Leadership coming in a couple of months. So it's just that 45 minutes gives the young people in the audience an opportunity to hear about organizations that they may not have been exposed to otherwise. but it also allows them to vent in a safe place where they're not judged. And I'll go back to the safe place in Rape Crisis Center. When Spark comes in, you know, they open up the floor to have the young people share if they feel comfortable, or they share their literature so they know that there's a safe place to go if something's going on.
And how about the co-op counseling service?
Correct.
Is that what
it's the risky behaviors piece, and that's that sexting. I mean, it's funny because this is very new. This technology piece is new to us. And I don't think the parents understand the seriousness of the social media, the bullying, the cyberbullying that we're seeing on there. And again, going back to that sexting, and that there are consequences for that, even though they think that they're just doing it among friends.
So even if it's the person sending the sexually related material or receiving it, you work with both of those.
That's correct. That is correct.
And hopefully dissuade them. I think that would involve perhaps working with the parents also.
I agree. The parents have to attend those meetings with their child. And the facilitator that we have has been with us for a zillion years and actually started a program in Manatee County, where he saw that this was turning into what we see today.
So if you were have to encapsulate the mission of the teen court, what would you say that would be?
Giving young people a second chance free of a conviction on their record. Yeah, giving young people an opportunity to have their voices heard.
Well, it sounds like a lot of things that parents can use to keep their kids straight, and the kids can keep themselves straight. Well, this is all we have time for today. This is a popular program. At Teen Court Orientation, which I've attended, the courtroom is filled with students and interested parents. Matter of fact, it's standing room only. I know this because I've sat as a judge for teen court and seen the enthusiasm firsthand. Heather and her staff have achieved amazing results for hundreds of kids over the years, saving them from the stigma of a criminal history, a history that could have affected their future, environment, employment, military service, college loan grants, and professional licenses. So, if you're a parent concerned about your child's behavior, contact Teen Court. See if the program meets your family's needs. And if you're a student needing community service work for college applications, Teen Court's a great option. So give Heather a call. They won't turn away any contributions either, I don't think. This is Lee Haworth signing off for Law in Sarasota. Thank you for watching.
For more than 36 years, the Community Foundation of Sarasota County has worked one-on-one with estate planning attorneys and their clients to make a lasting impact through philanthropy. Stable, trusted, and knowledgeable, the Community Foundation safeguards the charitable legacies of donors to ensure that they continue for years to come. Visit www.cfsarasota.org or call 955-3000 for more information.